Welcome to the Center for National Policy at the headquarters of the Truman National Security Project. My name is Scott Bates, and I'm president here at CNP. And on behalf of our partners, the Christian Science Monitor, Passcode, and IBM, welcome to our ongoing series on cybersecurity. 1 year ago, we gathered here on the very day the President of the United States launched a landmark executive order on cybersecurity. And today, we've brought together leading practitioners in the field and government leaders responsible for strengthening cybersecurity while promoting information sharing and building resilient systems. Our purpose is to look back and to see how far we've come in the past year, and to look forward and to discuss how far we have to go to meet our goals of strengthening security while protecting privacy and promoting innovation. Just days ago, the President held an important summit at Stanford to discuss some of these very issues. There is a clear and compelling reason why cybersecurity has gained so much attention at the presidential level, and that is because in the 21st century, cybersecurity is national security, and the foundation of our prosperity will be built on secure and resilient cyber systems. And so I believe the issues we discuss here today to be central to the future of our nation. And in that spirit, we very much welcome your active participation in the program today. Now, our first speaker is kind of like having three cups of coffee in the morning, so you're lucky that way. He is full of energy, and he has been focused on these issues for a very long time. Andrew Breen is a federal chief strategist for IBM i2, Threat and Counterfraud Information and Analytics. As a business develop executive at IBM Analytics Group, Mr. Breen is focused on helping federal agencies seize opportunities and meet challenges using big data and disruptive analytic technologies. Andrew is a defense council member at the Truman National Security Project, and in that capacity, he's an active member of the Center for National Policy Cyberspace and Security Program. He's also a member of professional organizations committed to U.S. leadership in areas of security and technology, including the U.S. Global Leadership Coalition, Business Executives for National Security, the National Defense Industrial Association, the Armed Forces Communications Electronics Association, the Intelligence and National Security Alliance. He is also chairman of cybersecurity.org. And prior to joining IBM, Mr. Breen had leadership positions at a reconnaissance robotics startup. I think he flew a drone around at our annual conference. Is that right, Andrew? I remember that one. He was a program manager for open source intelligence at an international big data company and serve government customers with public finance investment banking services. Please join me in welcoming Andrew Breen. Thanks, Andrew. Thanks, Andrew.
Good morning, everybody. And thanks a lot for the very warm welcome, Scott. And thanks to our friends here at the Center for National Policy and the Christian Science Monitor and the people at Passcode for putting together this really important event. First off, I want to introduce a few of my colleagues from Big Blue, from IBM. One of our systems architects, Robbo, David Robinson, is with us. He actually is one of the key talent behind a lot of the technologies that I'll talk briefly about. And I think he's going to add value and augment really our whole nation as we look at intelligence to provide enhanced cybersecurity for the government and for the private sector. I'd also like to introduce Matt Campbell, who leads our specialized account management team for the Department of Homeland Security and other civilian agencies, and Jeremy Blade, who's another one of our business development executives. If you have any questions, feel free to contact any of us. We can walk you through things in more detail. So I'll start by paraphrasing Vice President Joe Biden, and I'll tell you that cybersecurity is a big deal. In the past year, and unfortunately again just last week, we've too frequently seen organizations picking up pieces after yet another major cyber attack or breach. Looking forward, what we need to do as a government and as a private sector is be proactive and disrupt these attacks before the damage is done and before the theft has occurred. Overall, cybersecurity is a big deal because all of our lives are enmeshed in the cloud. On mobile devices like my iPhone in my pocket, we all live in cities with SCADA systems in the energy grid, in the public utilities, and public works. Increasingly, we have the Internet of Things in our very homes. Cybersecurity is a big deal because by very nature, cyberspace creates an expanded universe for opportunities for what former director of National Counterterrorism Center, Michael Leiter, used to call micro actors with macro impact. And we saw that in the terrorism paradigm, and we're now seeing it evolve in the cybersecurity paradigm as well. And while cyberspace has been identified as a major area of concern for the federal government for years, the number and impact of recent attacks on major U.S. corporations has been widely reported only recently. Just last week, data theft from Anthem, which is, I believe, by some accounts, the second largest health insurer, may have compromised Social Security numbers and personal identifiable information for upwards of up to 80 million individual Americans, including their CEO, I believe. So we've all seen high-profile cases of cyber theft. What's also happening is cyber espionage and cyber attack, where data is being destroyed or stolen and used for national advantage. In federal agencies, financials, retail, and now entertainment at Sony and even insurance, the costs are enormous. Center for Strategic International Studies estimates up to $500 billion almost every year lost in, to society at large as a result of cybercrime. That's more than $1 billion a day. Now, these threats come from a wide spectrum of attackers. Just recently, in 2014, we saw the Department of Justice move forward with indictments against PLA Army nationals for cyber espionage. On the national level, the FBI made allegations that North Korea may have used national elements in the attacks on Sony. On the other end of the small-scale vandalism, we saw ISIS militants hack the Twitter account of CENTCOM. So you see a wide variety of actors, and you also see a very broad spectrum of types of attacks. Malware is proliferating every day. The types of social engineering schemes that are used to attack the human element of organizations is also increasing in sophistication. And the one common characteristic of all of this is that the digital data sets from which all those threats emerge are absolutely enormous. The sheer scale and complexity of these structured and unstructured data sets coming together could drown or crush our cybersecurity analysts and our national security professionals, or we could find ways to harness that data, leverage it, and interpret it to yield actionable insight. Now, broadly as a nation, I think we've seen some significant hints at the kind of damage that can be inflicted. And we've got numbers to show that it is costing more than $1 billion a day. But I'm very optimistic that as a nation, we've hit an inflection point with regard to cyberspace. I think what we do now is what we have always done as Americans when faced with an obstacle or a challenge. We'll find ways to innovate, work together, and leverage public and private sector resources to protect our commerce, our way of life, and our personal lives. Stakeholders from business and government are already thinking, acting, and adjusting as needed to reduce risks in cyberspace for Americans. In the past year, on the government side, the President acted decisively, took executive actions to help unite efforts protect cyberspace for Americans by coming out with a new executive order and a new policy framework, empowering the Department of Homeland Security, identifying areas of critical infrastructure, and creating a NIST framework. Last week, the White House announced a new agency, the Cyber Threat Intelligence Integration Center. Now, CTIC, and I'm not sure that's what it's going to be abbreviated as, is fantastic. It's going to be built on the same model as the National Counterterrorism Center. And it could do for American security what NCTC did for counterterrorism intelligence. It's creating a central clearinghouse where analysts can leverage the work done at multiple agencies, bring it together, fuse it, and share it, hopefully as needed, with government and also private sector entities that need to protect networks. But their work is cut out for them. Because if you want to find a needle in a haystack quickly or connect multiple needles in the same haystack, you'll need the whole haystack. And you'll need to exploit information in it. And from what I've read, CTIC is going to be a small agency with 50 employees. They'll be dedicated to leveraging the analysis of those other agencies. That means people will be working with volumes of data not in the megabytes or the gigabytes or even just a few terabytes at a single go, but they'll be working with hundreds of terabytes, perhaps even petabytes of analytical products and potentially raw source material. It's a big job. On the private sector side, all of us as citizens need to empower the right team with the right tools and the right technologies. And all of us have a role to play in that. I can only speak from my own experience, but I really am overwhelmingly proud to say that I am now an IBMer. For more than 100 years, IBM has been solving the world's most challenging computing process and data problems. And I'm really honored to be part of that team with people like Bravo and Matt and Jeremy. In the past year, IBM also made some significant announcements related to evolution and innovation for cybersecurity intelligence. One of which was the release of what we've called Enterprise Insight Analysis. Formerly, it was an internal initiative codenamed Project Aurora. And Project Aurora was a next-generation big data analytics program that pulled together resources from proven solutions for link analysis, artificial intelligence, identity resolution, and sense-making algorithms to provide a single user interface that simplifies extremely complex investigations for those analysts I was talking about at places like the Cyber Threat Intelligence Center, or places like the Department of Homeland Security, or our intelligence agencies, in ways that protect privacy. So to give you a brief preview, we'll play a video now. This is the part where I juggle.
Technology enables untold opportunities for consumers, for organizations, and for criminal exploitation. Because with technology comes a massive amount of disparate data. Data that criminals and perpetrators use to mask their identities and activities. How can organizations and agencies simplify trillions of disparate data points fast enough to identify actionable insights and act before perpetrators do? IBM helps you unleash the wealth hidden in big data by automatically resolving seemingly unrelated entities 24/7. So you can run complex queries across hundreds of terabytes of data and apply three-dimensional, advanced analytics, all at the same time. An integrated system of insight that transforms data complexity into actionable intelligence within seconds. That's the power of Big Blue innovation. That's the power of IBM i2.
So obviously a technology solution like i2 Enterprise Insight Analysis has many uses where insight needs to be deciphered from masses of seemingly disparate data. But given the cyber intelligence discipline's reliance upon extremely diverse structured and unstructured data sets, EIA will be especially valuable as it will empower fusion of the biggest, most complex sets in order to augment the best parts of human insight. It's going to deliver the power to act before a cyber attack is complete and before a data theft has occurred. It will transform the historical postmortem analysis into a power that empowers policy leaders to look at ongoing course of action analysis. It will generate options for organizations, whether they're governmental or in the commercial sector. And I think most importantly, because it runs at enterprise scale and with a speed that will reduce calculations that used to take hours or days, as recently as last year, into seconds and run them simultaneously. I firmly believe, and I say this as myself, that this is the kind of innovation that will allow nations and organizations to move their efforts from forensics and cleanup into the realm of what we'd call proactive defense that preempts, disrupts, or prevents attacks before they occur, before the damage is done and before the headlines are written. So I'll wind up where I started. Cybersecurity is a big deal because the stakes are high. All of our daily lives in this room are intrinsically linked to technologies that put us at risk in cyberspace. It's undeniable. That inextricable link is exactly why we need smart, talented, and forward-looking professionals in the government, like Deputy Undersecretary Phyllis Schneck, with her current colleagues in leadership across government, and the yet-to-be-announced incoming team at the Cyber Threat Intelligence Integration Center. Along with the many thousands of civilians, soldiers, Marines, airmen, and law enforcement professionals who work every day to protect our nation and our networks. So I want to thank all of our participants and everybody who's watching on the streaming session, but I especially want to thank those professionals who've committed themselves to public service, whether they are in or out of uniform. And I'm available for questions after this event. Thank you, everybody.
Good morning, everybody. My name is David Grant. I'm with the Christian Science Monitor, and Dr. Schneck will be out in just a second, just getting her mic'd up backstage. Just one second.
Well, thank you very much, Andrew. Appreciate that. Our next guest is Dr. Phyllis Schneck. She serves as Deputy Undersecretary for Cybersecurity and Communications for the National Protection and Programs Directorate. She is, in short, the Chief Cybersecurity Official for the Department of Homeland Security. Ms. Schneck supports DHS's mission of strengthening the security and resilience of the nation's critical infrastructure. Schneck came to DHS from McAfee, Inc., where she was Chief Technology Officer for Global Public Sector. She was responsible for the technical vision for products and service for public sector, as well as global threat intelligence, industrial control system, and telecom strategy. She drove strategic thought leadership around technology policy and cybersecurity, and led initiatives in adaptive security and intelligence in networks for critical infrastructure protection and cross-sector cybersecurity. Ms. Schneck has led a distinguished group of people and has had an amazing career in security and infrastructure protection community. She was working group chair of the CSIS Commission to advise the 44th President on cybersecurity. Ms. Schneck was chair of the board of directors of the National Cyber Forensics and Training Alliance, a partnership between corporations, government, and law enforcement for cyber analysis to combat international cybercrime. She also served 8 years as chair of the National Board of Directors of the FBI's InfraGuard program and was founding president of InfraGuard Atlanta, growing the program from 2,000 to 30,000 people during that time period. Not surprisingly, she was named one of Information Security Magazine's top 25 women leaders in information security. She holds 7 information security patents and has 6 research publications in the areas of information security, real-time systems, telecom, and software engineering. Ms. Schneck received her PhD in computer science from Georgia Tech and pioneered the field of information security and security-based high-performance computing at Georgia Tech. So without further ado, the chief of DHS's mission on cybersecurity, Phyllis Schneck. Please welcome the doctor. Thanks for coming. Appreciate it. And not only that, she just balanced her coffee and her remarks. Yes, in two hands. Well, thank you very much, doctor, for being here. And this is a bit of Groundhog Day because you were with us, I believe it was about a year ago, and the president had launched his executive order. I wonder if you might just kind of fill some of us in who may not be as versed on the executive order and give us an update on where you think we are right now and where we might be going.
That's a great question, and thank you. I just want to see, can you all hear me? Okay. Technology better now? Yeah. I found the on switch. So good morning. I also want to thank our sponsors, so I'm told I2 and the Christian Science Monitor and the Center for National Policy. This is a really important subject, right? And we're celebrating a birthday, birthday of our framework. So February is a big month of birthdays in my family, and there's now one more. And I want to highlight that for a minute, where we're going and where we are right now, as you point out, with the EO. But the EO is in some ways a culmination of many things that have happened this past year. If you think about DHS, our secretary always says, cybersecurity is a part of Homeland Security. And cybersecurity is a key priority, one of the top for the department. And we look at it not just in the National Protection and Programs Directorate where I sit, but all across the department, from TSA to FEMA to our Coast Guard, our Secret Service, our Homeland Security Investigations, which is actually part of ICE. So I'm going to try not to use a lot of acronyms this morning, Customs and Border Patrol, but the whole department. It's a unity of effort, and cyber cuts across everything. And then you force multiply that as we work with our partners in the interagency, the FBI, the intelligence community, for example, and many others. So when we look at where cyber is right now, I think back to 2 years when the framework was starting to get created. I was in the private sector, and I was really excited about this thing because all the scientists were going to the meetings. I'm a nerd. And looking at how to build basic good practices for cybersecurity. Not compliance, not legislation, but just how do you do this, and how do you adapt it for a business of any size, a state, local government, a federal government? How do we put risk management, asset inventory up front, and then look at how we want to invest? How do we take cybersecurity to the boardrooms? So about a year ago, we launched the framework. And at DHS, we look at this as our C-cubed voluntary program. We're government. We had an acronym. But that is critical infrastructure, cybersecurity, community, the three Cs. And it's voluntary. And we've had a ton of adoption. This has been killer. We've had adoption from small to medium businesses that before didn't have good cybersecurity, and we're still working on increasing their cybersecurity. We've had adoption from large businesses saying we want those smaller guys who feed us and our vendors to be more secure before they connect to us. We've had adoption in looking at state and local governments, how they invest upfront in good cybersecurity. And it's been leveraged across several awareness campaigns. We've been able to go out with our protective security advisors, which for those who may not know, those are our feet on the street, come from the Office of Infrastructure Protection across the country, that understand all the local infrastructure, so not just cyber, but everything cyber enables. We've had our cybersecurity advisors that pair with them to look at the core cyber infrastructure. We've offered all the resources of DHS, from our US CERT analysis to critical infrastructure resilience reviews, all in line with how do you, as this framework is aligned, designed by scientists in the private sector and NIST and DHS and others, how do you line this up so that businesses can, and state and local government and government, put risk management, consequence management, and create real resiliency instead of buying numerous devices that may or may not work to secure what they need. A key part of this is the private sector engagement, probably the most important. How is it that we turn this framework, it's a living, breathing document, object, if you will, or concept, how do we make it continually useful? How do we keep it so that it continues to advise? We've been working with the big four or five or six or whoever you want to call that number, but the large groups that are going to help us measure in metrics. So how do we know the actual impact? We see the impact in the awareness, but we don't always know what the individual companies are doing with it because we don't ask them to report. That's private to them.
What are some of the incentives, do you think? What's the feedback where companies are coming back to you and saying, you know, we're happy to assume that this is all voluntary, we're happy to do it, we're happy to invest the time and money that it takes to meet these standards? I mean, why are they doing this?
I think for two reasons. One is a key executive at the launch, if you recall, said that his incentive was fear. What could happen if you don't secure your resources and your networks? I think the others that are being asked for, and the big one, is cyber insurance. And how do we look as a community at how do you enable that as a business and mitigate that risk for the companies that buy in? But the concept is very clear. It's like anti-lock brakes. Mm-hmm. Make your car safer, the premium goes down, drive safely, et cetera. Mm-hmm. In cyber, we have very little actuarial data. So we're working with our interagency partners and private sector, and namely the financial sector as well, to look at how do we build a data repository, or should we build a data repository of events and cyber events. And I would preface that with, and we'll talk a little bit today about our strategy and how we really focus on situational awareness. That's my number two priority. Number one is building trust with you and with everybody that we secure and our stakeholders. But as we collect all that data, it's done with the expertise of our privacy and civil liberties experts. And that, along with the framework, should really be a big sort of umbrella over all that we do at DHS.
What are some of the challenges? If you could point out maybe one or two different sectors. The ones that are sectors that you see that are advancing quite well in meeting the challenges and meeting the framework, and those that have overcome some challenges, working with you, or if they've worked together to do that.
So the joke about this is, if you've met one sector, you've met one sector. Everybody's different. We have 18 critical infrastructure sectors, actually reduced to 16 a couple of years ago. But if you look at everybody's different, and the reason is what they're protecting is different. The culture is different. If you run a water utility, you actually use some of the same devices and mechanisms for digital signal processing to make valves open and close and circuits open and close to make things physically happen. But your entire business model and delivery is different. So the entire culture is different. So working with different sectors is one of the things I think that our team does very well at the department, along with our partners. As you know, the financial sector has been a leader in infrastructure protection since probably PDD 63 back in the mid-90s. But when you think about why, and I was told this by one of the experts many, many years ago. He said that in New York, all the buildings were very tall down on Wall Street, and they were dark, and they would all go to the same delis. So all the bankers would meet and share information, and they realized that working together, they were better protected, and it was good for their business to bond against the common threat, or the adversary, in those days, probably the bank robbers. But if you look at what they've done now, and I'll jump ahead a little bit, the key thing, one of the key things that's happened this year, besides the framework, and I think the impact of the framework and the credibility that has been bolstering in public-private working together collaboration, is some of the new legislation that we've gotten. So for those who may or may not know, as of the end of 2014, we now have FISMA authorities to assist. That is actually our role, to help protect our federal civilian government agencies. So if you think back to Heartbleed, we lost a lot of time in going in to protect those agencies because legally it wasn't actually clear. We were working from a patchwork of different pieces of different laws. It was always our role, but it wasn't clear in statute. Now it's very clear in statute that that's our role, so it isn't necessary anymore to get all the lawyers involved when we have to go in and take out a bad guy inside the network. So that will work much more quickly now. We also have our NCIC, our National Cybersecurity and Communications Integration Center, named as the central portal for information sharing. This will be the future of cybersecurity. I can't think of a single piece that's more impactful when you think of situational awareness. So DHS, and the things that I've learned over the past couple of years, DHS has law enforcement, but the NCIC is not law enforcement. So we have this great role where we can be a place, a civilian portal, to collect cybersecurity threat indicator information. So that's not your name and your address. That's, for example, a piece of malware or a scrambled up version of it, or an IP address if appropriate. But indicators of threat. We are the place where that is collected with all the expertise from privacy and civil liberties to do it right, from our interagency partners, from victims, from companies that want to share with us, and to be able to add those together and make more value, because we see, just like a big weather map, we see the different fronts coming together, and we can put that out much more quickly. So today, we share that information in near real time. And by near real time, I mean Secret Service, intelligence community, a lot of our vendor partners, state and local representatives sit on the NCIC floor and get the information when we do. So they're right there. FBI, everybody. In better near real time, what I'm going to call automated near real time, is what we're doing now. And that's where, given that we are the central portal, and you've heard about the president's legislative proposal from a couple of months ago that said they will extend targeted liability protection, which is a good balance of not just saying put everything out there and don't be careful about private information in there, but do it in a way that it's cyber threat indicators. Those will collect at the NCIC, and it's our job. This is being built right now. We will execute. This is our role in life to put that together, add value to it by the correlation, and get that out to the private sector, to our government partners, to everybody as soon as possible. One of the great values in that is that in collecting that information, you start to build an ecosystem. And the more people that participate, the more accurate the information is, and the more accurate the information is that they get. One of the things that has to make that work is a standard way of talking. So just like if government people speak to you in acronyms all day, you're not going to understand. I don't understand most of the time. We need a common language and a common way to express the data that we're sharing. We affectionately call those our two favorite acronyms, STICS and TAXI. But STICS is a structured trusted information exchange language, or threat information exchange language. It's a way of expressing a cyber threat indicator that will be recognized by the recipient, who's also using that same standard. And TAXI is Trusted Automated Exchange of Indicator Information. There's a quiz at the end. That's the, if you think of two tin cans and a string, the tin cans contain something that should be written in the STICS language, and this is automated. And the TAXI is just a protocol, just a way to get there. So machines will be speaking cyber threat to each other. And we are running this now, we're building this now, and the financial sector has graciously built software that helps existing products. So people don't have to go out and buy brand new products. It helps existing products speak STICS and TAXI so that you can receive and distribute indicator information. So when you think about the NCIC portal, a central repository for information, for very, very rapid sharing between people and machines, that will also get shared with law enforcement and also get within DHS, our Secret Service and our Homeland Security investigations, and then outside of DHS into private sector, and we can get indicators back.
You mentioned Congress, and you mentioned something positive in the authorities that you received. I'm wondering what you think, what would you say are your top priorities for Congress now? What kind of action should be required to get you where you want to be, to advance kind of the voluntary cooperation, but what else is on your to-do list that you'd be able to plug today, aside from like funding DHS?
I would like that funding. On the cyber side, specifically, we'd like that legislative proposal from the administration to pass. That enables that targeted liability protection, which is important. I was in a company 15, 18 months ago, and I was on the line to share information and do it right. You don't want to share too much information, but you want to give enough to the community to protect them. And you want to put it in one place and not make 19 phone calls. One place and know that the right people are going to get it the right way with all the privacy and civil liberties considerations. This will help that. This will further that. The NCIC is the right place to do it because it is not law enforcement. It will enable the medicine, if you will, to get into the internet while the investigations can concurrently be started if the providers of the information are working that way as well. So it does not in any way prohibit law enforcement investigation, but it speeds up, again, putting the indicators, putting the medicine into the network. I think that is absolutely critical, and we're working very closely with many gracious people on the Hill who are looking at a wide variety of laws on a wide variety of topics, not just cyber, and have taken a lot of time to sit down and really learn this stuff and share their insights as well. So I'm thankful for that. On the funding part, I think that's very, very important. Cyber will be effective, as will everything else. But I think on just the cyber part, that legislative proposal is key. In addition, in that targeted liability protection, if you've seen the new executive order that the president signed at Stanford about 5 days ago on Friday, it enables that targeted liability protection to information sharing and analysis organizations. So there's a new word in town, ISAO. I think that's how you say it. That's how I've heard it. So you've heard of the Information Sharing and Analysis Centers, the ISACs. They are a subset. Writing this down? Don't. The ISACs are a subset of the, I can't make this stuff up, but the ISACs are a subset of the ISAOs. And believe it or not, it makes a lot of sense. Because if you think about small groups of, they used to call it affinity groups or special interest groups, for example, certain kinds of stores or law firms or insurance firms that weren't covered under a typical sector that had a specific ISAC for it, would want to get together and share information. And why not enable them to also share information with the NCIC and give them the same protections as the ISACs would? So we want to be able to have a growing group of these affinity groups, because that's how trust is formed, whether it's a group of, again, law firms or a group of dentists or a group of airlines. There's an aviation ISAC as well. We want these people to get together to share their expertise and to enable those organizations to also provide liability protection, targeted liability protection, to those that share the information with them. And then all that will get to the NCIC. So I think the past year has been very, very enabling, legislatively with the executive order, with the president's legislative proposal to then add that liability protection when providing information to the NCIC, with the executive order that adds a larger umbrella on top of what organizations are really sharing information with that liability protection. I think that the adversaries will stop dancing in the streets as we pull this together, because this is the one thing they can't do. This is bringing together the information that enables machines to block what shouldn't get there.
Well, thanks. I'd like to open it up to any questions or comments from all of you, and don't be shy. I know you came here for a reason. Yes, sir. And please let us know who you are.
Hi, Dave Perry from Politico. Can you talk a little bit more about development of this data repository? There was a report out for cybersecurity insurance purposes. There was a report out from DHS maybe about 5 months ago that discussed the topic with cybersecurity insurance executives, and they roundly rejected the proposition of DHS having any role in such a repository.
So that's an ongoing conversation, right? That is, and the discussions I've been in have been much more what is the role of each organization, and much more, and I was just in a meeting about 2 weeks ago with another agency that was very open to our having a large role. So I think this is, like many things, an ongoing conversation. We all know that we need to get some actuarial data. We all know we need to reduce risk. And I think many of us believe that cyber insurance can be very valuable done the right way. It's my personal belief that I walked in on September of 2013 to the finest team in the world in cybersecurity, and that DHS, in a unity of cyber effort across all the organizations that make us up, is the right place to champion a lot of this work. And we will have a key role, whatever that's decided, with our stakeholders.
Thank you very much for your question. Yes, please.
Hello, Christine Vargas from Avicent. Could you speak a little bit more about your awareness campaigns to businesses and industries at large, but also to the general public?
No, that's a great question. I've long said and tried to figure out how to take cyber mainstream, how to make it not a nerd topic and not just when somebody's intruded and it's in the news, but how do we make this something where people are actually concerned about it? How do we help kids when they get a cell phone understand that you don't take calls from everybody, you don't text everybody? So your question, I'll start with the businesses and then get to the mainstream. On the business side, we use our critical infrastructure sector structure to work with all the different sectors. Each sector has, whether it's water or gas and electric or finance or government services, rail, telecom, each sector has a sort of policy body, a sector coordinating council, and an information sharing and analysis organization, the latter of which is more technical, sharing indicators. But we use those in many cases to understand what kind of awareness is needed or what kind of help might be needed from us or government as a whole for that sector. We also go to many of the larger conferences, take extra time, there's a very large cyber conference coming up. I won't name it, but many of you probably know what it is this spring. And we're bringing a huge team out there for just this point, to drive awareness to what needs to happen in cybersecurity, for what government's doing, and even more importantly in some cases, what the private sector can teach government how to do better. We have, with our Office of Infrastructure Protection, we do a lot of work, obviously, together with them. These two are inextricably linked. We go out to different sectors across the country. We help with the critical infrastructure resilience reviews and cyber resilience reviews. We can have feet on the street going in and looking at different infrastructure and where it's connected to the networks. Those resources are very available. One of the jokes that I made when I came into government was that, unlike some companies, DHS does a really good job and doesn't tell anyone. In a lot of companies, they market a lot, and maybe the product works, maybe it doesn't. So we are trying to overcome budget issues as well, but more outgoing awareness campaigns. But I think what we've done is more tactical and sat down with, whether it's different groups, whether it's business executives. I've brought our leadership, our secretary and deputy secretary, to meet with CEOs. My boss, Undersecretary Spaulding, and I go out and meet with venture capitalists out west. We do this a lot. We did this again last week, reason being that they are the edge of innovation. All those startup companies are making the technologies that could drive us to better, easier, more fun cybersecurity in the future. So we are getting out there at all levels. We work closely with the Chamber of Commerce, especially for the small to medium businesses, and through the multi-state ISAC for the state and local organizations as well. So our reach is, for the budget we have, I think our reach is very good, but our reach needs to be more. And I'm always open to questions or help from the press on how we can get that very important message out even better. On the citizen side, you've all heard Stop, Think, Connect. Hopefully you've heard it a lot. Every October is Cybersecurity Awareness Month, but to me, every month is Cybersecurity Month. So we want to make sure that we get, it has to be, right? We get those messages out as clearly as we can. We go to different areas around the country. We do basically a cross-country set of events, talking to businesses of all size. I personally and my team do a bunch of these all through the year. When we travel, we try to do more than one thing. If you're going to get on a plane and go somewhere, we try to see stakeholders at every location. So it's mostly, we don't have TV ads, or not the kind we should, but we really do try to work with you and with the press, with the Chamber of Commerce, with the state and locals, and with very large business organizations to really get messages out and to also take in input.
You need a bigger budget, and I appreciate your question, because I'll tell you what my 85-year-old mother, Barbara, said the other day. She was reflecting on the state of world security, and she said what scared her most was about cybersecurity. And she said she heard that they can take over our cars.
And they can.
Yes. So I just wanted to be able to reassure her that that wasn't true, right?
Well, okay. So your cars are wired. And this is where I would like to see citizens get more involved. Look at the things that you are, the agreements you're signing when you buy a new car. Look at what is in the car. Many of them have a black box just now, just like on the airplane. That can tell you things about how the car was operating at any given time. So look at these services when you buy the car.
Great. Yes, please.
Hi, Mitch Herkes with the National Association of State Chief Information Officers. Our members, the state CIOs, work a lot with DHS and the NCIC through the multi-state ISAC, but they also work either formally or informally a lot of times with the private sector through state information sharing organizations. Michigan has a formal information sharing sector. Actually, we found out a lot of states do recently, Georgia, Kansas, quite a few others that might fit under this ISAO definition. Over time, how could you see states or regions that want to create these ISAOs moving in that direction? What would they have to do to become one?
So this is a great question. We're just at the beginning of this, and I should also mention NASIO and the Council of Governors and the governors' organizations that we also engage with locally. This is just beginning. I think that there are already existing groups and efforts of people, like-minded people, that share information. The processes to go forward are just beginning to get defined. It's on us to set organizations to determine the standards to do this. We are just at the very, very beginning. That's why our funding is so important, but also making sure that that's informed and guided by our stakeholders.
You mentioned funding. I'd just like to ask a little bit more about what kind of disruption might occur in cyber with funding delays, if any. The continuing resolution saga disrupts a lot of DHS grant process, generally speaking, timing and so forth. What kind of problems might you encounter, or are you thinking through if this is an extended delay in funding?
Oh, wow. So we have meetings on this every day. We're very, very worried about it. We are planning for what we hope will not happen. This impacts everybody. If all of a sudden you had a fraction of your team and a fraction of your money, and a fraction of what you did every day that was important to your stakeholders, but you were not allowed to do it anymore, this would impact you. So we are working very, very hard to have contingency plans to minimize the effort to the stakeholders, minimize the effort internally, but it's a hard, hard hit. And cybersecurity is very important, so.
Thank you. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I'm Peter Kogler, former chairman of the Center for National Policy. I'm interested in how you prioritize subjects to be anxious about. Scott's mother is worried about cyber and cars. In Washington, we're worried about federal agencies. We deal a lot with corporate America. There are security insurance things. What do you look to see a list of priorities rather than just being fearful of so many things?
So this is a great question, and I think about this a lot and how we prioritize what we do and how what I worry about. And I come from corporate America before, and my background is high performance computing, so you could say I came from academia too. I've seen a lot of sides. I worry about the attack that hurts people. Okay, so all of the work we do with the Hill is to enable us, and they've done great work to help us there. All the work we do with our stakeholders is to protect them and learn how to protect them better. The end goal is to be resilient. It's so that when someone finds a really clever way to electronically or physically do something that has cascading consequences, that people aren't hurt and that consequences are minimized. So I worry about destructive malware, for example, but not to the point where dead machines keep me up at night. But what were those machines supposed to be doing that sustained something else?
I ask because one of the things that she does at Center for National Policy is to try to make people aware of what's really something to be fearful of versus some of the things we've been told by what we're supposed to be fearful of. So just one suggestion. It helps to really supply people with the facts, in my opinion, whether it's legislators or journalists or others, so that people really have a feel for what's a real fear versus a managed fear.
I couldn't agree with you more. It's a great question. I'd love to explore that more. That is a very big topic. Because in the end, and I've said this a lot, it's my mantra in a way, but computers are not smart, they're just fast. And because of that, they can do something that they didn't intend to do, because they don't have minds. They just fetch one instruction after the next. And all you have to do to get this fast, powerful machine to execute your will instead of a good will is to get the evil instruction to be the next one on the pile. And you can buy software overnight from your bedroom on how to do that.
Yes.
Yes, Chris Costello, Inside Cybersecurity.
Thank you. Hi. What do you think needs to be done to enable benchmarking so that individual sectors and companies that are trying to use the framework, for instance, to get better, have a sense how they're doing compared to their peers in their sector and other sectors?
This is another good question. We've spent a lot of time talking about this because you can't, as a scientist, you can't judge progress without measuring. But as a DHS leader, when we enable and have companies adopt the framework en masse as they have, we don't require them to report back to us either their state before the framework or their state now. So it's tricky to understand what progress has been made. We have to look at other indicators. I used the word cyber threat indicator before, but other ways to look at how the threat is either propagating or are those threats becoming more sophisticated. Believe it or not, when threats become more sophisticated, we're doing a good job. Because that means that we've wiped out some of the bottom feeders and we've wiped out a lot of the noise. And when the very sophisticated threats start hitting, that means two things. It means the company saw it early, we know about it. And it also means that it wasn't buried in a bunch of noise that they could have protected by changing their passwords. So this is very tricky, and that's why we're working with those big four or five firms to understand what's the right way, whether it's from an audit capacity or in some other methodology to really quantitatively measure that impact. I don't know if that answers your question. That's an ongoing problem.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. Yes.
David McWhorter from the Homeland Security Consulting Group. Piggybacking on that a little bit, instead of quantitative information, if one uses the framework to look at the levels, you know, level 1, 2, 3, 4, and using that as a benchmark, it's a self-evaluation, and it's of course voluntary. Is there any what role do you see DHS playing in evaluating the evaluators? You know, maybe it's one of those big companies that comes in to do the auditing. Do you see any role in looking at those auditors and somehow blessing them and saying, if these guys give you level 4, then you're level 4, anything like that?
So my sense is this is under development. You're raising some of the questions that I think have been coming out in, not the repository conversation, but other conversations, I think, in the insurance piece as well. How do you assess a baseline and who gets to do that? And is there a business forming around that? So I think a lot of this ties together. You know, how do you measure impact of the overall framework? I think the greater awareness is also a result of impact of the overall framework, and as well as the mass pickup of the state and local on using it. We wrote a check last year to give managed security services to all the states if they would adopt the framework. And by adopt, I mean put together a methodology on how they're going to do better investment for cyber and work through those different stages. I think all of this is tied into different parts of that conversation. And it's one that will be ongoing. And it's one that I think we're all privileged to be a part of. We are very, very open to input. I got a write-up from one of my team members I do my homework. They send me home with a book every night, and I read it. Probably if I stopped reading it, they'd stop giving it, but we haven't done that yet. And one of the write-ups was a summary of a meeting that happened, I think, yesterday or Friday. And it taught, one of the sentences that someone said in there was, this was a very collaborative meeting, I'm paraphrasing a little bit, but said, unlike most of these meetings with government agencies. You know, ouch. So I want to make sure that we are much more, you know, and I think we are getting there, approachable to have these kinds of conversations. It's really difficult, it's a big understatement, to actually measure an impact when we should not be digging into the business of the company. We can ask them to report, and many will, but many won't. And so statistically, that's a challenge.
Very good. Yes, please.
Thank you. Yeah, Eric Levy Myers, the Wainwright Group. I'm kind of curious, you mentioned a few of these, but how you work with other organizations who do cybersecurity for the federal government. I was thinking the National Cybersecurity of Excellence or Cyber Command, for examples.
So great. We have a lot of interagency partners. That's the umbrella that I call for other agencies. So for example, the National Cybersecurity Center of Excellence, working directly with NIST, we have people that look, and this comes also within sort of our partnership side, that looks at those different companies, those different partners that might be demonstrating technology there. Those are also partners of ours in other programs in cybersecurity information sharing, where they actually send their scientists in and explain what threats they're seeing. And it's not, they all sign an agreement, a federal agreement called the CRADA. It's a research agreement that helps us understand what the biggest threats are right now. And that doesn't ever leave us, but it helps all those people transcend the competitive boundaries and work together against the common adversary. Cyber Command and the intelligence community, so DOD, the intelligence community, as well as the FBI, are great partners. We work very, very closely. For example, in the automated information sharing, we've had groups of people meeting several times a week, including FBI, and that will include intelligence community, and how those automated protocols should look, how information is collected in the NCIC, how we can leverage that to provide better information and faster out. We work very, very closely. For example, when big investigations happen, you can turn on the news and see a company. You can be confident when you see a company that's had a large cyber intrusion that no matter who's investigating it, they've all been on the phone. So the NCIC is on the phone with the FBI, is on the phone with the IC, no matter how that works together. I should also mention, it's a great time if you don't mind, the new CTIC that was announced. I don't know, but that was announced just last week, I believe, in Lisa Monaco's speech last Tuesday. And what that is an intelligence integration center. So not to be confused with the NCIC. So the CTIC is to connect the dots on the intelligence activity. So that's a government activity. And that's to make sure that there's full context, again, connecting the dots, so that we can give context to those threat indicators that come to the NCIC. The NCIC is still the indicator integration. And the NCIC is what touches all the private sector, the state and local, the federal agencies. The CTIC is more of an intelligence coordination function, but a very, very necessary one. And I think it will make us very sharp.
Yes, please. Someone who hasn't asked a question, I think, in the back. Yes.
Ann Lalina, the Lalina Group, thank you so much for what you have done and your team, Dr. Schneck, and what you're going to be doing. In that regard, could you comment, the private sector has had some issues with getting cleared and getting access to some of the information that is very desirable and useful for them. Can you comment on what DHS is doing in your area with regards to getting more cyber info out, including the classified info?
Absolutely, and thank you, Anne, and you were a huge part of our team when I knew about that. So, and thank you for your kind words. This is a huge question. So let me divide it into a couple parts. One is classified versus unclassified. There is a wealth of information in the unclassified world. We are trying very, very hard and successfully to get more information out into that wide open world. I come from a private company, and I know that a lot of the information that was thought to be government only, super secret, spooky, was actually well known in the open source. So we are doing a lot of work to try to get more information out to the unclassified level so that it's more useful in the mainstream. On the classified side, we are working with our partners to enable clearances for people that we feel need them, and that would be useful. I view that as more of the exception rather than the rule. As a scientist, I truly feel that there is so much we need to be pushing down that I don't want to focus too much of our time trying to isolate certain information. But there's a case for both. There's also a great thing that we have that enables private sector and civilian government to be protected with classified information. So you've heard of our Einstein program. I know it hits the news on some regular basis, but at a high level, that protects the perimeter of our federal government agencies. So we are able to do that, and some people call it intrusion detection. I've had people come to me and say, isn't that 10-year-old technology? And I say, they expect a really defensive answer, and I say, no, it's not. It's 25 years old. For those who remember, IDS is older than some of us here. But what this program is far beyond that. It's the ability to do two things that are very different from any other program, and that's why we're investing so much. One is to be able to protect all of our federal civilian agencies at once. So imagine the situational awareness, and I can tell you I've seen this because we're building it out. When some threat tries to get into one agency, and we notice it there behaviorally, not by a signature anymore. A monkey can do a signature, and I can quote that. What you want to do is not have to just block anymore on something you know. You want to be able to block on something that, like your body fights a cold, on something you start to understand is bad. We can do that by understanding what's hitting our entire government. That is a piece of situational awareness we've never had before. Secondly, we can use classified indicators, classified information, to protect those government agencies and use classified information to protect private sector companies as well through our enhanced cybersecurity services programs. Now, a key thing here is we are, with our privacy people, collecting data back from the protection of the federal agencies. We are not collecting anything from the protection of the private sector. We are using everything we learn protecting the government to also protect the private sector, including the government-furnished information or the classified indicators. So I think that's a very important distinction. There's no other program in the world that can find a way to use classified information to protect private sector. And it happens at real-time speed. And just as a plug, that piece of situational awareness that we're now developing is also getting combined with data we get from partnerships with the private sector, which is also combined with data we can get from the multi-state ISAC and others that furnish it, so all in partnership. That will then combine in situational awareness with the automated real-time information that comes in at warp speed through those automated protocols where everybody's talking about what they see. And that's what I call internally, affectionately, the weather map. So imagine when you have multiple NOAA weather satellites that help you build a picture of a hurricane as it's forming. You can better predict the path of that storm, better understand how cold or hot or wet it's going to be in each of the states it transverses. And that's what we're doing in cybersecurity. The top is a picture. A heat map, if you will. Sometimes I call it executive eye candy. Underneath that is analysis, hardcore analysis that we can do from the data that we retrieve by protecting the federal agencies, combine it with data that's gone through, in some cases, in the private sector, Hadoop clusters or supercomputers, combine what we see with what they see, and push out a combined with confidence levels sense of awareness, and again, do it at machine speed. Many companies are already doing this. We are putting it together with what government can do.
Time for one last question. In the back, yes, Mr. Former Assistant Secretary.
Hi, I'm Todd Rosenblum, just liberated from DOD Homeland Defense and DHS before that. So thank you for hanging in there. The question I have is on the role of DHS in seed money for new technologies for cybersecurity. And I say this in the context of, for example, DARPA. What it does on applied research and identifying future needs for defense. So for example, the Google Alliance on password authentication, is there a place for DHS now to be planting seed money for looking at technologies that are needed for cybersecurity 5 years out, that it's gonna take government to help spur the growth in that, you know, that area of requirement?
This is a great way to sort of wrap up. So our Science and Technology Directorate does fund a lot of what they call leap ahead or up and coming technologies. We talk a lot with them. We're working more closely with them than ever, looking at how do we get in a cycle, a better cycle of where they are building things that we will need 5 years out. They have good relationships, as do we, with the innovators out west in Silicon Valley, the innovators here. So I think that's an ongoing collaboration. What's the role? What's the budget? But certainly I think there's a huge role. We have a very talented group of researchers and science and technology director spanning far more than cyber, and I'd be happy to continue that conversation.
Well, thank you very much. I think I can say that we've come a long way in a few years on this topic. In 2002, when we created the House Homeland Security Committee, I was on the first staff member on the committee, and we said to ourselves, we think we need somebody that understands computers and cybersecurity. And that was one person out of 20 on the staff. And our knowledge base has only grown. That common language you're talking about has grown within DHS over time. And you've done a lot in the last year since the executive order. So thank you for all your progress for this update. And please join me in thanking Dr. Schneck. Appreciate you coming here. And don't go yet. We've got a very interesting panel that is right on tap. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for sticking around for us. Can everyone hear me okay? Great. My name is Mike Farrell. I'm the editor of Passcode. Came down from Boston just for this. I'd hoped it would be warmer. It's actually warmer today in Boston.
Less snow here.
Less snow, yeah, no 10-foot piles of snow to traverse. But actually, Passcode, if you guys don't know, we just officially launched yesterday. So hopefully you're signing up, because we'll be writing about and talking about all the things that, you know, been talked about here today. So we've got, what I want to do with these two gentlemen, who I'll introduce in a second, is to break down a little bit about what we've been hearing about earlier in the program, to how do we bring that to actual reality and to the real world. I think in Washington, as Washingtonians will say, are really great about talking about problems, analyzing them, coming up with acronyms for them and new solutions. But when it comes to moving that out into the wild or into reality, it's a whole other problem. So without further ado, I'll introduce these two gentlemen. We've got John Pescatore, who is a longtime computer industry specialist and practitioner. He's the director of the SANS Institute, previously an analyst at Gartner. And early in his career was really into tinkering with things at the NSA. So he's got a lot of knowledge to share with us on the subject of information sharing and improving cybersecurity. And next to him is Harley Geiger with the Center for Democracy and Technology, or did I get that?
You got it right.
So, you know, one of the things that, you know, hasn't been talked about that much, at least here, is the, as we move into legislation to about information sharing, is how we consider the privacy implications and civil liberties. So, I mean, certainly DHS is talking about that, but what does that really mean in practice? And I imagine you may have sort of jumped at the word when IBM was talking about, you know, getting a whole haystack, which is something that the privacy folks certainly don't really like. So love to get you to talk about that. So maybe we'll just jump into it with John and talking about how, you know, what I'm always struck by is that, you know, there is a tremendous amount of information that's already out there. Companies should be really well protected already in terms of security, but we keep having these breaches. So is, in your view, information sharing the answer, one part of the answer, and how can that really make a difference when it when we're talking about defending against real-world attackers?
Sure. Well, I mean, first off, information sharing legislation is sort of the perennial flower in, around here, right? It comes up every year. There's not a tremendous need for it. There's some tweaks, removing some potential antitrust-type worries of some legal counsels, but the reality is most industries already have their own ways of sharing information, as Phyllis Schneck talked about. There's a financial ISAC, retail starting one up, the high-tech industry has their ways of communicating. I think too much of the focus has been on there's some glaring need to share threat information. If you think about it, think about all the years we've had antiviral software where they all share threat information. Well, it's always too late when you get that information because these days the bad guys change. Where there's a lack of information is sort of sharing on how did some companies succeed in avoiding attacks and removing barriers? Why did Home Depot get hit real bad but not Lowe's? What was Lowe's doing differently or better? Steve Belevin, who was one of the earliest thinkers in the firewall world, I think he's now the CTO at the Federal Trade Commission. He had a great idea a couple years ago. Much more important thing the government could do was have something like the major cyber incident response or investigative team. Just the way when a plane crashes, the National Transportation Safety Board sends a team out. Why did United 104 crash while Southwest 127 just happily flew through the same storm and landed safely? Then they come back with lessons learned and share information about what should be changed so this doesn't happen again. Glaring lack of government leadership in that role. Yet another database where the government would have yet another database of threats. Really not going to change the equation one way or the other.
Well, I mean, what is the view from the industry about just the government push on this front in general? I mean, do they have that sort of view of like, oh, this is just another layer of government bureaucracy? We'll participate, you know, at a level that we're comfortable with. And what's just generally their sense from the private sector?
Well, if you remember when the in the lead up to the framework coming out, I can't remember which was the senator from West Virginia, Rockefeller, I think it was, sent a note out to Fortune 500 CEOs, sort of a questionnaire that most of the CEOs had their chief information security officers fill out. I was working at Gartner at the time, and many of these were our clients, and so had a lot of visibility into it. And a lot of the feedback was, there are things we need the federal government to do to make this easier. A national breach law, for example, was a comment to get us out of this mode of 50 different states operating 50 different ways. There were some definite things they came back with. They did not come back with, there was a lack of standards. Right? There's every industry already has security regimes or standards, and there was no real need for another government one. The framework did a nice job of sort of mapping across all the different standards into one common view. But I think the reality is what we often see from the need from private industry, from the government side, is a couple things. One is, Ms. Schenck referenced PDD 63 that President Clinton put out back in, what was it, 98 or 99? One of the key elements there was the government should be a model citizen in cybersecurity. Government services should be the most secure and should drive the market for secure products and services. We haven't yet seen that, but we have seen the FedRAMP program, by the way, and the federal government start to drive increases in cloud security for the providers who want to sell cloud services to the government, the Googles and Microsofts and Amazons. So we actually have seen examples of where there are market mechanisms being used by the government that then tend to draw private industry to doing things more securely than they would to meet the broad market. So I think those are the major areas versus any need for new legislation or more databases.
Well, it does seem like there is this drive for new legislation. Things are certainly lining up behind it. I mean,
there's an old saying, you know, painters paint, legislators legislate.
Right.
That's the tool they have.
Yeah. So Harley, I wanted to bring you into the discussion. What are the concerns you see going forward about legislating information sharing?
So first, to build off of what was just said, so we agree that information sharing is not the silver bullet. I mean, it will make some difference, but there are a lot of things that companies should be doing, and many of them are doing, that will help prevent cyber attacks and data breaches. Digital hygiene is a really important practice. If you look at things like the Target breach, the Sony breach, some of these things are not really going to be preventable by sheer information sharing. Nonetheless, we do think that information sharing does have some value in preventing cyber attacks. It will help develop more robust threat indicators and enhance defensive agility. So we do think that it's valuable. The question is really what type of information sharing are we going to have? What sort of infrastructure? To your question about privacy concerns, there are several. The president's executive or draft legislation actually does a very good job of avoiding some of these. First, we do not think that the head of any sort of cybersecurity coordination effort should be a military agency such as the NSA. We think that it is properly located with the Department of Homeland Security. In addition, some of the legislation, not the administration's proposed legislation, but some of the legislation that we've seen previously would have companies share information with the Department of Homeland Security, which would then be required to share it in almost real time with other agencies, including the NSA. So it's almost no different from if it were going to the NSA directly at the outset. The administration does a good job of creating space to avoid that problem by saying that each agency, including DHS, needs to have privacy policies in place regarding the disclosure, the sharing, and the receipt of information. Those policies are not yet written, however, like the administration's proposal did not include them. So what those policies actually say in the future will have a great deal of impact on how individuals' privacy is protected. There are several other points in the administration's proposal and other cybersecurity legislation we can talk about. But I want to mention two things. One, there is already a provisions in law for private corporations to share information with the government. The Electronic Communications Privacy Act, the Wiretap Act, for example, all allow private corporations to share information with the government in order to protect their own networks, but only their own networks, not other people's networks, not other companies' networks. And that can be fixed with a simpler amendment than the sort of cybersecurity legislation that we're seeing right now. What we think needs to be incentivized, and which is currently lacking from the administration's proposal, is incentivizing and giving liability protection to companies to share information with each other, not necessarily with the government, but between companies. After all, most of the critical infrastructure in the country is owned by the private sector. However, the way that the legislation is shaping up, it is shaping up to be notwithstanding any privacy law, and share it with the government, and then you get your liability protection. So it almost forces a government-centric sharing regime. We think that is one approach, but we think that the most significant problem with the administration's proposal is that it does not incentivize that private company to private company sharing. The second thing I want to mention about that is a perennial problem with information sharing is what the use of that information will be once it is shared. And what we don't want to see happen, and this is a possibility under some legislation, is for companies to be able to share anything, notwithstanding any privacy law. So we've had privacy laws on the books, they're there for a reason, but companies can share it, and then that information, once it goes to the government, can be used for law enforcement purposes. And each cybersecurity legislation package that we've seen so far does allow for some law enforcement use. The administration, we think, has a pretty reasonable limitation on law enforcement use. They limit it to computer crimes. We'd like to see that defined more, but they limit it to computer crimes, threats of death and serious bodily harm, and sexual exploitation of minors, and a couple of other things. We think that's pretty reasonable. But if it is open for general law enforcement use, then it essentially becomes a giant backdoor wiretap. That is a major thing that we want to avoid.
So talk a little bit more about the privacy concerns in some of the information sharing legislation that's out there, and what are some of the real issues and that consumers, people should be worried about? You know, are they are we talking about, you know, sort of a, you know, a whole data set of information containing social security numbers, addresses, internet, you know, activity being handed over to DHS? Or?
So it depends on how the legislation will define what can be shared. The administration's proposal, for example, requires only cyber threat indicators to be shared. And those cyber threat indicators include information that can describe a technical vulnerability or a means of access and other technical exploits. But the administration's proposal requires that information to be stripped, or rather requires companies to take reasonable steps to strip information that would identify a specific person from that information prior to sharing, unless it is necessary to describe the threat. That is, we think, a pretty reasonable way to go about it. Unfortunately, that would include victims because they would be related to the threat. We have some tweaks that would potentially shield victims more, but that is much more narrow than, for example, simply saying that you can share anything at all. And if it is anything at all, then potentially, I think that this would be a bad practice for a company to do, but if it's anything, then sure, a company could share a data set that includes social security numbers and other sensitive personal information. And that we think would be a problem. Individuals should not have to choose, and companies should not have to choose between being vulnerable to cybersecurity attacks and sharing large quantities of personal information with the NSA.
And I think a similar issue there is you've seen recently come out of the US government, the UK government, concerns about bad guys using very strong encryption. Mm-hmm. Sort of, wait a minute, we shouldn't allow that. There should always be a government way to get through encryption. Sort of harkening back to the old crypto export debate we went through 25 years ago. It's another example of a technology really needed by people and companies to protect their information and protect their privacy that runs counter to both national intelligence and national law enforcement needs, erring on the side of making it harder for people to protect themselves enables the bad guys. There's things now that would be encrypted already and routinely if we hadn't been fighting encryption so hard 20 years ago when it first came about, made it more difficult to get baked into things. So some of this we see in the U.S., especially since we've basically taken a national policy that's put in leadership for cybersecurity on the national defense intelligence side versus the law enforcement side. So we're treating it more as a war-type issue than a crime-type issue. And that leads to, in wartime, you tend not to worry as much about privacy or worry about people protecting themselves as you do during law enforcement and other things where we have well-established routines of that balance of privacy versus security.
I strongly agree with you on the encryption point. There are calls, these calls have been around for a long time from the United States, but we're seeing them ramp up also in Europe, China, for example, to require strong encryption to have a backdoor built in to facilitate state surveillance. And this will undermine protections for both individuals and companies and have a real economic impact because you are essentially selling products that are surveillance ready. And that will be hard for the United States to do in a place like Europe or Asia.
How do you ensure that you only have good actors in an information sharing arrangement? There are, you know, many cybersecurity companies that are essentially run and funded by, you know, adversarial governments, or, you know, do you keep them out of any kind of information sharing agreement? I mean, there seems like this is a ripe opportunity for, you know, putting out bad information just for the sake of maybe sending somebody in the wrong direction.
Well, I mean, in the security industry, there's a lot of history behind this. You know, for example, Microsoft several years ago started a program of early sharing of vulnerabilities so companies could get ready for patches, and then also early sharing to the security companies so they could do signatures and so on early. And it quickly had to face that issue, who do I share with? So they had to put in place some vetting. The vetting can't be on a nationality basis. We're a global economy. We have as much to lose if other countries outside the U.S. won't share information with us as they have to lose if we don't share with them. So it's not foolproof, nothing's foolproof against malicious insiders. But there are, again, rampant information sharing that's being done widespread for solutions to these problems. That's quite often why you see, and Kaspersky's in the news, a Russian company, for being one of the first to figure out this equation group code that's been out there. There's a lot of sharing leading to that, and they've had a pretty good track record of keeping the serious information out of the hands of the bad guys.
And then there's the the sort of the global nature of this as well, right? Because if you're thinking about, I mean, it's not just enough for a U.S. company to stop an attack. You know, an attack could start in Europe, infiltrate into the U.S., and all of a sudden you have a huge global issue. So how did they fit into the mix? And I mean, that's also a different kind of privacy paradigm there as well, because they're much more interested in protecting privacy than, say, the U.S.
Sure. Well, they also have a lot of exceptions to their privacy rules as well. Mm-hmm. But you know, we think that information sharing can help prevent some of that. I mean, that's part of the point of it, is to prevent attacks from cascading from company to company. But it would be far more valuable for those companies not to be vulnerable in the first place. And a great deal of that will be good coding and a lot of digital hygiene. And we think that this is an area where many companies around the world need to improve, frankly.
It seems like, you know, if the information is out there, you'd think that big companies like JP Morgan or Target or Anthem could stop some of this stuff from happening in the first place already. But, you know, clearly they can't.
Well,
you were talking about the incentive, right, that they have to do it.
Let me jump in there. You know, how many planes landed safely the day the last one crashed? Mm-hmm. Right? We don't say planes can't fly because they crash occasionally. So let's use Target as an example. Huge, $150 million, let's call it $200 million incident last year. Target's a $72 billion company. In the retail industry, they lose 1.5% of revenue to shrinkage, shoplifting and employee theft. And they spend 1.5% of revenue to keep it there. So standard industry practice in retail, you lose 3% of your revenue to the cost of shrinkage, of theft, of crime. Of a $72 billion company, 3% is what, $2 billion? So last year, 2014, Target lost $2 billion to shoplifting and employee theft, and less than $200 million due to cyber threats. So they protected themselves pretty well. All the years before that, they had an incident. Banks still get robbed. The real issue is we're evolving to be what is an acceptable cost of incidents. The cost will never be zero, because then commerce will go closer to zero, right? So in retail, we've been tracking these numbers since cavemen sold sticks and rocks to each other, right? It's the industry we have the best data on. That's an acceptable cost. When you think about things from a put your life and safety lens on, you say no incidents are acceptable. But planes still do crash. We will have another hijacking event. We know that, even though we made things much more secure, the doors are now much more secure. So the real issue is, how do we get better at it? Why aren't we getting better faster versus nobody can stop anything and the government needs to step in and do something? When you look at why did Target make these bad decisions about its point of sale terminals, and why did somebody else, like a Kohl's this time or somebody else, said, oh no, we already updated ours, we don't have the problem they had. These are the areas where you get into information sharing. For example, a group of retail CISOs, I worked with them last winter when they were starting up, we need an ISAC. One of the key things they wanted to share was why some of them were already moving the chip and pin and encryption, whereas others said, oh, we've heard you can't do it, versus any need for legislation to remove those few barriers. That were mentioned. So I think, you know, there's a lot of examples of the majority of companies don't show up in the news for having been
right, hit. Right. So there has to be more of a financial incentive, I mean, for these companies to take more proactive action. Because Target could have done this, but they chose not to for whatever reason.
Well, think about Sony's incident. Huge, tremendous. Think about the bomb movies Sony's put out.
Right.
You know, they put out a totally bad movie and it spent $200 million and made $5 million. Whereas Disney put out a $200 million movie that made $500 million that same year. So, you know, a lot of these come down to business decisions.
Right.
And what was mentioned, you mentioned a couple times, I think is very key. SANS has been behind a thing called the critical security controls, or the idea of digital hygiene, mm-hmm. to say there are some levels that just have to be met.
Right.
It's not a business decision to say, yeah, we really don't need to let the employees wash their hands before they make the hamburgers, right? That's not a. The Federal Trade Commission's probably been the most effective government agency in going after companies who haven't met digital hygiene standards for protecting their customers' data, using all the existing laws and its authority. you know, and forcing companies, you didn't meet this minimal level, you're going to get penalized, you're going to be audited, examined for 10 years. It's done great work for 10 years.
Do you think that information sharing would have really had a strong effect in preventing something like the Target breach? I mean, my understanding was that Target, Anthem, Sony, all facilitated by spear phishing attacks, mm-hmm. and that the companies themselves could have been protected if they had updated their systems, encrypted their data, and that doesn't sound like something to me that information sharing can solve.
You know, I think the areas where information sharing really does help, there are already mechanisms in place. For example, the defense industrial base. So the contractors that are building things for the DoD, we know foreign nations, we know China has specifically targeted them, and that's well documented. So they started up, the DoD has started up a program called DivNet, the Defense Industrial Base Sharing Program, because in that case, if one ball bearing manufacturer says, hey, I got this weird attack, they notify the people who make the turbine blades and everything else so they can be prepared. Very smart area for information sharing. In most of the broader fields of business, they have information sharing. All these laws are about information sharing upwards to the government, not facilitating east-west sharing across industry, because that's already there where it's needed.
Yeah. So if I get it right, we're kind of split on the need for information sharing legislation. You're for it as long as it has the right privacy protections in place. You say it's not needed.
Well, I'm saying it's not a fact. I think there are some things that could be tweaked that would make some chief legal counsels less worried, some things that would provide better protection. Mm-hmm. For example, I would like to see requirements on how well the government protects that information.
Agreed.
Because it's going to be a very lucrative target.
Well, the administration's proposal would have some requirements regarding the protection of information that is shared.
And some oversight, transparency.
Sure. Yeah. But our position actually is that information sharing can be accomplished through a much more narrow means. And actually, I think we're actually more on the same page than perhaps it might seem. But we think that information sharing could be a lot more narrow. We think that it ought to focus more on existing information sharing provisions in law, like the ones I described earlier. ECBA, the Wiretap Act, for example. You can share to protect your own network, not others. That can be changed with a simple amendment, not by creating this large-scale information sharing, government-centric paradigm that all the legislation is moving to. In a way, though, since all the legislation seems to be aimed, or at least the major legislation seems to be aimed at that government-centric, large-scale paradigm, we are commenting on that paradigm. But our ideal is actually to facilitate greater private-to-private information sharing. In the end, a lot of what is holding it back is liability. It's liability protection, and that's what companies need.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like there's a bit of a disconnect, right? Because the way the internet and communication systems have been structured, these are private enterprises. They're over private networks, and the people who have the switches and the controls are working in corporate America, not government. So, in a way, we're almost reliant on good corporate behavior to be able to keep us safe. So, I mean, it would make sense that the government is then pushing them to do the right thing. I mean, there has been a suggestion that the government should be the single biggest payer for bugs, for instance. So they create the incentive in the marketplace. So companies who are in the vulnerability business are incentivized to then reveal their information. So maybe that's a better way of going about it, just create this marketplace.
Well, but it depends on what your goal is. Is the goal for the federal government to have yet another database with lots of cool threat and vulnerability information, or is the goal of the legislation to increase security of the infrastructure?
Well, that should be the end. That's the
right, that should be
goal,
the
right?
Goal,
not just sharing for sharing's sake.
So there's a lot of other elements proposed in legislation that I think have much bigger potential for increasing security. You know, there's other bills, I forget if it's actually legislation or just administration effort. It was called Buy Secure, mm-hmm. which is say the government should be buying more secure software, more secure network services, and driving the market in that area. There was another one about the workforce training. Now, I worked at Gartner for 15 years talking with Fortune 1000 and government customers all the time. And one thing I realized, everybody has the same access to technology, mm-hmm. and in reality, the same access to information. But why were some companies more secure than others? Why did Veterans Administration do really badly in the government and Social Security do really well? And a lot of it comes down to the skills of their people and the training of their people. Are they able to attract and keep people that are good at cybersecurity, just like a good software developer? So there's legislation around the cyber workforce training. Those are, I think, efforts that will have more concrete impact on real levels of security. For some reason, the information sharing one, though, is this irresistible, like the swallows coming back to Capistrano every year, that right. some version of that bill comes back. And whether it passes or not, I really don't think it'll ever make much of a difference.
But we think that it will pass, actually. We think that Congress is poised to move information sharing legislation. CISPA passed the House last session. We expect that some version of it will do so again. And because of all of the buzz and motivation based on recent high-profile hacks, I think that Congress may very well get this done this session. And the question then becomes, from our perspective, from the perspective of a privacy and civil liberties organization, is this legislation going to protect privacy and civil liberties? And we think the administration's proposal does a pretty good job of that, and some of the legislation that's been proposed previously does not.
So one of the analogies I heard recently that I thought was interesting to comparing information sharing to some real world technology was comparing it to the Waze app, right, which gives real-time traffic information for drivers. But there's a downside to that, right? Because if you're driving, you shouldn't really be looking at your phone, and you're sort of taking your eye off the road, which you should be really paying attention to. So as we're focused on information sharing, is there something that we're taking our eye off that we should be paying more attention to in the cybersecurity space?
Well, again, I think there's been an over-focus on the sharing of threat information, and less, not enough focus on the sharing of how did you overcome these barriers to getting more secure. Why are you able to use encryption when we can't? Why did Target make this decision? And that's just the natural way of competitive business. I think there are things the government can do. Again, I mentioned the Buy Secure program to say, hey, if the government starts buying more, so if the government drives software suppliers to lower levels of vulnerability, and we share information about which pieces of software have fewer vulnerabilities because the government's requiring that as part of their buying, that helps drive the market. We have NIST, who's an agency in charge of standards and testing things, right? They have the standard test for this ruler actually 12 inches long, or does this fire extinguisher work? For 10 years, they've fiddle-farted around with how do you test software for vulnerabilities instead of actually the government doing it and starting to try it. So I think the information sharing about the products and services that can be used to be more secure, the government could play a huge role there. More information of threats and vulnerabilities, there's dozens of sources of that already. There's no attack we can point to recently where lack of information sharing was really an issue.
You mentioned also the Federal Trade Commission earlier, and their authority in this area is limited but valuable from our perspective. They have, through litigation, established that companies that don't meet a certain reasonable level of security are subjecting their users to unfair marketing practices or unfair trade practices, and so they could sue under their Section 5 authority. This position is constantly under attack at the Federal Trade Commission, but we think that actually solidifying and expanding that authority may do more to prevent cyber attacks than some of the other proposals that we've been talking about.
Yeah, I agree. And if we were to, I remember years ago, after one of the plane crashes, there was a congressional hearing and a safety engineer set up and said they were proposing, since some babies died in the plane crash, they were proposing babies would have to wear seatbelts. They could not be hand-carried. So the engineer stood up and said, well, you know, then people will drive more because it'll be too expensive to buy a seat for the baby, and more babies will die because the rate of death is higher per mile when you drive than when you fly. And the senator said, we're not talking about driving here. We're talking about flying. So, you know, the issue we're talking about information sharing, the real issue is increasing security. The single biggest thing that could be done to increase security and stop most of these threats is if we incentivize moving away from reusable passwords. So phishing attacks can't succeed, can't get into. Here we have the IRS. So I'm going to file my taxes using a reusable PIN. The most sensitive thing I do with the government is still done totally insecurely. So there's lots of things, government initiatives that could drive levels of security higher. Again, I hope the information sharing bill passes too, so maybe then we'll move on.
I hope the attention will move on to more meaningful. I see.
But unfortunately, a lot of what Congress and the administration are focusing on, I mean, if you look at the trio of legislative proposals that the administration issued, there's information sharing, there was a data breach notification, and then there were updates to the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. And of those three, we've really only been talking about information sharing. So the focus is not necessarily, has not necessarily been on things like digital hygiene or IT procurement, which may actually have a larger impact. We view the updates to the CFAA as actually having a negative impact on society at large. The data breach notification legislation comes up every session in multiple forms. There are already 47 states that have data breach laws out there. The question really is, are we providing consumers with greater protection through federal legislation, or are we just making things simpler on businesses, which is not necessarily protective for consumers?
Yeah, that issue is depends where the bar is set in the national legislation. If it's set reasonably high, close to, say, what a California does, it could make it a lot easier for businesses to protect data. It pushes the other way and just opens a whole bunch of loopholes. You know, it's just going to lower.
And the vast majority of the data breach legislation we've seen trumps all state law and is lower than a lot of states, particularly California, which has probably got the strongest data breach notification out there. If they raised all states up to the California level, we think this would be valuable for consumers. But, you know, trumping stronger state laws and saying we're going to put it at a weaker level, we think is actually damaging.
So let's open up to the audience, see if anybody here wants to get in on our conversation. Anybody? Any questions?
Information sharing, and that there seems to be a lot of information out there. I don't think there's really a shortage of it. But what are your thoughts on maybe sharing not just best practices, as you were alluding to earlier, but analytic capability or interpretation of that information as more of something to share? Just interested in your thoughts.
I think you heard Phyllis Schenck talk about things like taxi and sticks, which are standards that allow sort of the automated sharing of a lot of threat indicators and a lot of information. Then you hear from private industry what are typically called indicators of compromise. And there's proprietary ways and some open source agreements on that, which essentially are ways of sharing the analytic output to say, hey, this threat, here's the tracks it would leave, so look for those tracks. That has proven to be helpful. There's no impediments to that being done, really. It's a typical marketplace thing where you may choose one vendor or one community or others and do it more or less effectively. But yeah, certainly the ability for the good guys to use the internet to share expertise against the problem has proven really powerful.
I think analysis sounds like potentially very valuable and would remove some of the civil liberties concerns with sharing the actual content. And if I may, just for folks in the room and watching who are following the federal legislation, I'd pay particular attention to what can be shared. Is it everything, or is it a limited subset of threat indicators? And where does it go? Does it go to the NSA? Does it go to DHS and then the NSA automatically? Or is there a space between DHS and the NSA? And then what can that information be used for? General law enforcement purposes or a very narrow set of law enforcement purposes? I think those are the three big components that at least privacy and civil liberties advocates will be watching for when this stuff hits the floor.
Anybody else? I did. You brought up the Computer Fraud and Protection Act, which is another big topic that we haven't talked about. A lot of people in the research community say that making that, you know, creating stiffer penalties is a chilling effect on the research community. Do you buy that?
Yes.
Why is that?
The Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, the penalties that are already written into the legislation are draconian. And what the administration's proposal, as well as several other legislative proposals, would do is actually make them a lot stiffer. And it is completely unproven whether that would actually be a deterrent to individuals who are violating the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act. And at the same time, the Computer Fraud and Abuse Act is so broadly written that it actually encompasses a great deal of ordinary internet behavior. The Computer Fraud and Abuse Act, or CFAA, makes it a crime to violate a terms of service, or a website notice, a privacy policy, or an employee agreement. So even if you are authorized to access a computer, if you exceed your authorized access, then you can be liable under the CFAA. It's actually very, very broad. And it's a difficult problem to solve. There are reasons why that provision is there. The administration, to its credit, did take some steps in trying to narrow that particular problem I just mentioned, but they did not narrow it a great deal. It's a very big issue. And from the perspective of a security researcher, sometimes security researchers do have to exceed their authorized access, or they do have to break something in order to test whether or not it can be broken. and suddenly they're subjected to not only criminal liability, but civil liability for doing so. And that can be a major deterrent, especially if you don't have the resources to combat charges.
Yeah, in general, that legislation is mainly there to protect people who sell weak things. Because there's no example in the history of security of stopping people from testing the security of something, improves the security of something. Yeah. So those type of laws that try to limit what security researchers can do or what bad guys can do are totally crazy. Look at the Bugs for Bounty program. We know right. Those have increased the level of security. We've seen it over the past couple of years. That's asking people to break things, then notifying and get paid for doing it.
So in a way, we should be encouraging that behavior, right?
Well, the Bug for Bounty programs do, basically, right?
So. But if someone is, submitting a bug that they've found because they've broken something, are they in violation of this?
In some cases, yeah. It's, as you mentioned, it's so broad that it can be interpreted that way.
Unless they're authorized to do it, and right. For bug bounty for bug programs, they can they are presumably authorized, and so they're not exceeding their authorization. But not every company has such a program, and there are a lot of bugs out there.
Great. Well, thanks very much for your insight, guys. Thanks for sticking around. Appreciate it.
All right. Thank you.